Gentlemen, I want you to pay attention because what you're going to see is a bit of history in the making, and it's something that you're not going to see again. Our next four guests in the early 60s were undoubtedly the most famous four Irishmen in the world. They came together from Carrickonshire and Quay de County Armagh to sing songs that generations of Irish people had neglected, and they had lain dormant for generations. And in singing those songs, they sang their way into the hearts of millions of people right across the world, but particularly in America, as well as the UK, and here in Ireland. And not only that, but they paved the way for a whole host of other people to do something similar in music. In the way of all good groups, after 12, 13 years in the business, they split up and they went their separate ways. And they are coming together for the first time in 15 years to do a show in the Lincoln Center in New York on May the 20th. Now, it's a beautiful place, the Lincoln Center, the Avery Fisher Hall, and it seats 3,000 people. And the booking opened last week. The show is not until the 20th of May, and already, we heard today, it is booked out to capacity, not a seat left, which will give you some idea of the measure of popularity that they have in the United States. 15 years later, they are coming together for that, and 15 years later, they are coming together on the Late Late Show tonight. So when you welcome them, you are welcoming, literally, a living legend of music, if I can put it that way. Would you welcome, please, the Clancy Brothers and Tommy Makem. How about that? How about that? Hello.
I'm the boy to please her, and I'm the boy to tease her. I'm the boy can squeeze her, and I'll tell you what they'll do. I'll court for life an Irish man, and I'll go with Barney too, as they come to Ronnie Drew.
Well, here I am from Paddy's land, the land of fire and town. I broke the hearts of all the girls for miles from Kitty Town. And when they hear that I'm away, they'll raise a hullabaloo. When they hear about that handsome lad, they'll follow them. As her other heavy do, no more she'd have the handsome lad that they followed on the who.
For I'm the boy to please her, and I'm the boy to tease her. I'm the boy to squeeze her, and I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll go to like an Irish man of the broken Barney to his me Rolligan, Stolligan, Alligan, Mulligan, Baldo, Dunne,
who. I hear that Queen Victoria has a daughter fine and grand. Perhaps she'd take it into her head for to marry an Irish man. And if I could only get the chance to have a word or two, I'd soon she take a notion in the bowl of Dunne who.
I'm the boy to please her, and I'm the boy to tease her. I'm the boy to squeeze her, and I'll tell you what to do. I'll court her like an Irish man with a brogue and Barney too, as me pen me rollick and swanick and hollick and rollick and bowl of Dunne who.
Sit down there, for heaven's sake, and make yourselves comfortable. Oh, I see, the bones.
There's life in the old bones yet.
The bonnes are coming off already, are they? You're
bloody right, or else you'd be taking me out of here in a sponge.
That's right, can't stick the heat, huh? I knew you were weak fellas all the same. There's no doubt about it, for four actors, you can certainly turn out a song.
Thank you.
Let's start at the basics. Why are you coming together again, pray, after so long?
Who's going to answer that?
Go ahead, Lee.
I'm the closest. Basically, we're getting together to do a film of a kind of a documentary history of the group before we all become too antique. And we were getting back together in Ireland to do some of the filming. The film will culminate at Avery Fisher Hall on the 20th of May. We should get a load to come over, as a matter of fact. It'd be great. But we'll be filming down the country, down in Carrick, and taking Tommy back to Katie.
Yeah.
And you very kindly gave us a reason for all coming together ahead of time. Mm. And here we are.
It is a notion that we had about 2 years ago on the Late Late Show, but you weren't of a mind to do it then. But now you are. And how long will you stay together this time? Is it just for that one show, or do you...
God willing.
Well, we're just going to do that one big show in New York, and you never know. We might be doing a show here in Ireland if, if we're offered enough money.
Do you mean if you're made to feel
that's
welcome,
right,
like, I see. And what about Australia and Britain and places of that?
It could happen.
Ah,
very
Tom,
far
I
away.
Thought so. Yes, I thought
but
so.
But it's Tom. A little doubtful.
We haven't really
thought about that. We don't think that far ahead.
Did you never think that far ahead?
Oh, we were in Australia several times.
Well, I know.
No, gay means did we think that far ahead of doing shows in different countries?
Yeah.
I think it'd be lovely, but I can't get these fellas to agree to it.
As far as thinking ahead, when we first took our first engagement out in Chicago in 1958 at a little club called the Gate of Horn, we sat down and wondered among ourselves if we should abandon
we had a mass meeting, all four of us.
If we should abandon our various careers to go out and do this thing.
Yes.
And we decided at the time, the hell with it, we'll give it 6 months. That was in 1958. So here we are.
Still doing
it's gone on and on and on. One never knows.
Now that I see Tommy removing the Bonnie sweater, would somebody tell me something that I wanted to know for a long time? How did the Bonnie sweater bit start?
We had a manager who saw him, a good Jewish boy from New York. He saw us walking in one very wintry day with him to a rehearsal, and he said, that's what you'll wear, because we couldn't decide. We had white shirts and
how jeans. We got them, Gay, is our mother, the Clancy's mother, sent over three of them to Willie, Paddy, and I.
Yeah.
And I had bought one out of Martin Standen's in Galway.
Right. Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Martin, there's a plug for you.
83 years later.
Very good.
And
we wore them. It was winter time.
Yes.
And our manager saw them and he said, that's what I want. I want something to show that you're from Ireland, etc. And
it's what they call in the business now, packaging.
Right.
He was looking for a package to put us in, you know.
He was a smart boy, wasn't he?
Was.
He?
But they were very unusual at that time, Gay. I mean, very few people had them. I mean, I remember wearing one and people saying, where'd you get it? It looks lovely, you know. Is it Norwegian or something?
Do you ski?
Yeah. In fact, we were going to do a concert in some place in Connecticut one time, and we got into this taxi, and we had the sweaters tied around our necks, you know, and Tom was looking very burly, and we were talking. The taxi driver kept looking over his shoulder at us, and the address where we were doing the concert was at a gym, you see?
Stadium.
Yeah. Yeah. And he said, you guys are wrestlers or something? Well, he could have been, right?
There was a wrestling team going to do a match at the university in Connecticut that
day. Russian wrestlers?
Yeah, because Gorgeous George was on the train with us. You remember Gorgeous
George?
Oh, yes, with the
blonde. I remember that. The fellow with the big blonde head of hair and so on.
Tell me this, lads. Now, we've all heard about the Ed Sullivan Show. I'll be darting around the place tonight trying to figure out how it all started and how it came all together and so on. But the Ed Sullivan Show was the cruncher, wasn't
That's
it?
That's right. Yeah,
yes, tell me about that now. When was it, first of all?
When was it?
It was 1961.
61, yes.
Yeah.
We were playing down in Greenwich Village in a club called One Sheridan Square with the famous jazz singer, Josh White, blues guitarist and singer. And his manager was a Jewish New York manager who spotted what we were about, but couldn't figure out how he was going to fit us into the business.
It was this Martin.
This
Martin,
the same Martin
Ehrlichman.
Yeah.
So he mulled this over. He figured that we had talent, that there was some kind of excitement there, and he didn't know how to utilize it. So he decided he would put us into an uptown club called the Blue Angel, which is a very, very fancy place. It was one of those places where the walls, instead of wallpaper or paint, they had mattresses on them.
They were upholstered.
You know, nobody in the entire place spoke English.
Not even ourselves.
I remember one night, Ava Gardner sitting there, and the manager another night came to us and says, gentlemen, please no rebel songs tonight. Edward and Mrs. Simpson are out front.
And they couldn't speak English either.
But they had a good grace to leave before we started doing our thing. But in putting us in there was a kind of a stepping stone onto the Ed Sullivan Show. And that's where the packaging came in.
Yes.
He didn't know what we could wear because we looked like terrible slobs.
Yeah.
And when he saw the four sweaters, he said, "That's it. That's it. That's what you're going to wear."
But now...
That's what you're going
to
wear.
But now, to come on to the Ed Sullivan...
The actual show, yeah.
That place was a place where the Ed Sullivan Talent Scouts went to see new talent. And they came there when we were there one night. Jack Dempsey and Jim Downey and the man from the Ed Sullivan Show. And they came and asked us right then and there if we'd do some of the Ed Sullivan Show. But it was the kind of a place now that our manager, Marty Ehrlichman, had another client that he asked us if we would allow his client to do one of the sets for half an hour in the middle of, instead of us. We said, surely, you know, and she was a very pretty girl, and she went on and she did some beautiful songs, and her name was Barbara Streisand. Well, and so she, of course, became very famous, and we lost our manager.
When you say she was a very pretty girl, I remember distinctly Marty Ehrlichman says, "This chick," he said, "that I've got is going to be the next Judy Garland, if I can get her to have a nose job."
Well, even with that. But what happened on the actual Ed Sullivan Show, which was a showcase for talent on television and so on?
Well, we went up on the Sunday to do it, and we were to do two songs. And when Ed Sullivan came on and saw us, he sort of liked us. And there was somebody supposed to be on another act, supposed to be on the show, and they didn't show up or something happened. And instead of getting somebody else, he expanded our section on.
And how many did you
get? He asked us to improvise an extra 15 minutes. And so we ended up with an unprecedented 18 or 20 minutes on the show, which was unheard of.
Yeah.
At that time. Wearing the iron sweaters, of course. Yeah. And within the following week, we heard that the sale of iron sweaters jumped 700%.
Now, to give an idea of how, you know, there's 40 million people used to watch that show. And we were around New York, and at that time, our following was folk music people, not Irish, necessarily. Or very few Irish.
Very few Irish, yeah.
But once we got on the Ed Sullivan Show, it's like any blessing from the Pope at that time. He was looked up to by all the Irish.
Like
something like the Late Night Show, indeed. I was just about to say.
And when the following day after that, we went out to Chicago, and Tom and I were walking down the street looking for a place to stay. And there was fellas, now hadn't been in Chicago before. Fellas saw us, they probably recognized the sweaters over our shoulders. And they said, "Hi, boys, you did a great show last night." Tom turned around to me and said, "Hey, we're famous. We're famous."
Well, then I knew when we had it made, because we used to go to a place called the White Horse Tavern on Hudson Street. And we'd be singing in there, and old Ernie, who was an old German man who owned the place, didn't allow singing. But every once an hour he'd come in and say, "No singing allowed in here." So everybody would stop, and then we went out to the bar, they would start to sing again. And there was a woman upstairs kept complaining. And the police would come over from the 10th, was the 10th precinct? Yeah. And they all knew us, and they would come in and they would start and sing along with us and say, "You're making a lot of noise. There's a woman complaining upstairs," and then they would go up and tell her off for complaining. So after we did the Ed Sullivan Show, she had apparently been watching it, because the following day, Monday, she came into the White Horse and she said, "Are those the fellas that do all that singing every night and making all that noise?" And he said, "Yeah." She said, "Well, I saw them on the Eds. They can sing all they want."
That's sanctioned. Dick, what is your association with these fellows, or if any, or?
I live on the other side of New York City.
Yeah. Is that about it? Were you always a fan of theirs?
No, I'd say I was, yes. And I think
he was a babby.
1958. I was eight. Yeah. A bit more interested in football at the time, but I think it's fair to say they left a big impression.
Yes.
As they set off on that journey.
Yes, ambassadors of song throughout the world. Oh, listen, yes. I know that you have to go to Kerry.
Sure.
May we thank you very much indeed for joining us, and I know you're in a rush down there. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Dick Spring. Thank you very much indeed. Has a long journey ahead of him. All right, lads, sing a song, heavens. Don't just sit there. Sing a song, for heavens.
You know, they always pick on me to sing the quiet, nice, gentle little love song. Give me a key there, Willie. Yeah. Oh, when I was a little boy, so my mother told me, "Come away, haul away, we'll haul away, Joe." But if I did not kiss the girls, my lips would all grow moldy. "Come away, haul away.
away, we'll haul away, Joe. Now we haul away, the good ship now is rolling, Timmy. We haul away, we'll haul away, Joe.
Now first I met a Yankee girl, and she was fat and lazy, Timmy.
We haul away, we'll haul away, Joe.
And then I met an Irish girl, she damn near drove me crazy, Timmy.
We haul away, we'll haul away, Joe.
St. Patrick was a gentleman, he came from decent people, Timmy.
We haul away, we'll haul away, Joe.
They built a church in Dublin town, and on it put a steeple, Timmy.
We haul away, we'll haul away, Joe.
No,
we haul away, we're bound for better weather,
Timmy.
We haul away, we'll haul away, Joe.
Now, wouldn't that remind you of O'Donoghue's pub? I see Maureen and Paddy over there.
Yous have been rehearsing. Is that Maureen and Paddy? Good day to you, ladies and gentlemen. You're very welcome indeed. You were good friends to this lot in their day, were you
yes.
not?
Yes.
She fed us, for God's sake.
Did she have to?
No.
Not really.
She not only fed us, but I remember coming back from a tour of England and she took every penny that I'd made on the tour.
Oh!
God. She kept it in the back room and she'd only give me, she was afraid I'd spend it all.
Or lose
Wasn't
it.
She right?
Or lose it.
Wasn't
or
she
be
right?
Wrong.
That's perfectly
Indeed,
true,
right?
though.
So she'd give me a That's few bob at
true.
A time.
Yeah.
She was a mother and father to us.
Like a mammy indeed. Now, Liam and Paddy, or Tom and Paddy, you went first of all to America when?
1947.
Yes. And how did you go?
We went by, oh, that's a lovely story.
We went by ship.
We were in England, in London, and we decided that we were going to get out. It was cold, miserable, and the rations were on 1947 in the spring. It was a bad winter. So, we decided we were going to leave, but where to go? We decided that it was going to be either Australia, Canada, or America, if we could. So we tossed the coin, and it came down Canada. Now, where were we going to go in Canada? We didn't know anybody there. So we got a map of Canada, and they gave me a pin and blindfolded me, and I stuck the pin down and landed in Toronto. So then we had to find a way to get there. The American GI brides were all leaving England at that time, and they were being shipped over to the United States in troop ships.
You're not going to tell me.
And we got on one of the troop ships called the SS Marine Flasher. With 400 GI brides.
It was what? It was called what?
The SS Marine Flasher.
Flasher, the wrong.
And how many fellas were on as well as you?
Paddy and I and a fella called Pa Casey and a couple of other sailors.
And how many women were on it?
400.
400. And it cost us £28. For the fare, that is.
One way.
9 months later, there were 200 children. That woman has got to be stopped.
But wait, that went from Southampton to New York.
That woman has got to be stopped.
But wait, that went from Southampton to New York.
Yes.
And then we had to get from there to Toronto by train. We had a transit visa only for America. We couldn't get into the States. That is why, really, we were going to Canada. But when we got off the train in Canada, in Toronto, everybody got off and got into taxis and people kissing, meeting each other, and off they went. And the three of us, Pa Casey and Tom and I, were left standing there in the railway station. We had no address. We had nowhere to go.
And how much money did you have?
We had something just under $100.
Between you?
Yes. No.
Each?
About $250.
Oh, that's pretty good. Come on, yeah.
Well, we had a swift. We were looking at the rest of our lives and somewhere to live and something to eat. We had no source of income and knew nobody who could ever get us.
So anyway. There you were in the station anyway.
Yeah, and Tom went in for a haircut.
And a shave. Oh, yes. And a shoe shine.
And Pat Casey watched the bags, and I walked out, and there was a street that way and a street that way, and I went straight up the street. Didn't care which way I went. I mean, that was a decision. I could have gone either way. Went straight up and found a hotel. Went in, asked them if they had a room. A room, mind you. with enough accommodation for three fellas, two of being brothers. That made it very important to say that, because then we could get a double bed, you see, for Tom and I, and a single bed for Casey.
Casey didn't like to sleep with us.
So we got a bed there for the night, and the following day we went out and got jobs and digs, and we learned how to live in North America. We never looked back.
And then we got into the United States through two aunts. Aunt Marianna and Kathy were in Cleveland, and we found their address. And we got on a bus and got down to Cleveland, Ohio. And they sponsored us into the United States.
Yeah.
So at least we got over the border.
Yeah.
And then off we went from there.
Yeah. There's a fella in Katie asked me one time, what would it take me to America? I said, oh, about 80 or 90 pounds. He said, for God's sake, about 80 or 90 pounds, I wouldn't be going to America.
Now, when did the Plow and the Stars come? That fantastic excursion into show business and theatrical entrepreneurialship.
I'm sorry,
I got into that.
Well, in the when we got into Cleveland, Ohio,
yeah.
I started working in the Cleveland Playhouse at nighttime. I was a welder making bicycles in the daytime, and in the nighttime I started acting. And I got to know a bit about the acting. And I didn't know anything about welding either. That's another story. Yeah. And then we went into New York. And from New York, we both came over to Ireland in 1949, Christmas. And I got a job with Geoffrey Kendall and his Shakespeareana International Company.
I don't believe it.
And, at the Theatre Royal in Waterford for £2.10 a week. Paid in half a crowns. Cash from the box office. And I spent 9 months with him learning Shakespeare. We used to do five Shakespeare plays a week. And on Saturday night, we'd do Arms and the Man by Shaw. And on Sunday, we do Dracula.
Tom, Dracula would do you.
This is completely by the way, but what was your best Shakespearean role?
I really don't know. One of the things I loved doing was that there were so many parts that I could do in Hamlet. And I'd do Francisco, and then I'd go...
Polonius?
And I'd get back... I was doing the churlish priest... And the gravedigger, which was a neat trick because they were both in the same scene. As the gravedigger would finish, hey, pickaxe and a spade, do the whole scene. I get out of the grave under the stage, come back up with the cloak on. Our obsequies have been as far in love.
He does it well, doesn't he? All you had to do was add Yorick to that now, and you had a trio going straight away.
But after that,
anyway,
we went
yes.
back to the United States.
Yes.
Paddy sent me £60 in Ballybunion, County Kerry, for my fare. And I went back over on the Mauritania. And we got together again in Cleveland, came back into New York, and Paddy said to me one night, I was in a play. Paddy said, that play's not very much good, is it, Tom? And I said, no. He said, why don't you do a good play? I said, what'll I do? He said, why don't you do O'Casey's Plough and the Stars? And I said, I will, if you'll design the scenery. I'll direct it, we'll put it on. We pulled our money. We got another fella to put in a couple of $100. What was his name?
Noel Ben.
And we called it Trio Productions. We took over a theater, the Cherry Lane Theater in New York.
What did he know about set design?
Nothing. He knew to tell me how to do it.
Go on.
He was my advisor.
So you did the Plough?
We did the Plough and the Stars, and we got Sean O'Casey to agree to let us do it for so much money through the Madden Play Company. He gave us his blessing. He wrote a letter to me. I should have kept it.
Oh, dear.
Who knows? But anyway, we thought we'd put it on. We put it on for about $600 or $700, and in 21 weeks, we made $10,000 on it.
You're
profit.
Kidding. You're kidding.
And it had never run that long anywhere else.
$10,000?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And he got very excited then. He decided he was always interested in this Rice Playhouse up in Martha's Vineyard.
A summer stock playhouse.
And he gets on the phone. Poor Mrs. Rice was alive at the time. And he talked her into it.
Not for long.
And he talked her into it, and here we were. We packed all the sets.
We bought the theater from
him. Yeah. And we had to get a lorry to put all the equipment in. And we formed a company for summer stock, the basis of which was the cast of The Plough and the Stars. Went up to Martha's Vineyard.
We did Eugene O'Neill plays. We did Molnir, whatever it is.
Chekhov.
Shaw. Whole bunch. Very lovely artistic summer. Lost the 10,000 plus 4,000.
Sing another song. Sing another song. Stick to the song. That's it. Yeah.
You can see... You can see, hold it, I want to just say, you can see now why Tommy and I had to leave this group and go on our own. We never got a word in edgewise.
you will, yes.
I'm going to sing a song called The Shoals.
There you are, Mr. There it is. Welcome back, my friends. It is no harm to tell you at this stage that we are now inundated from all over the country with telephone calls from about 5,000 people requesting 5,000 different songs in the Clancy's repertoire. We are hardly going to be able to get to them all, but I'll take that lady out of suspense first of all by telling you that you're quite right. The jigsaw is Jim Mitchell, and you were the first one to guess it. So there you are. Could I have your name, please?
Mary Martingale.
Mary, and where are you from, Mary?
Beaumont in Dublin.
I see. And are you a fan of the Clancy's? For God's sake, give the
well,
right answer.
Well, they've just sang my song, The Shoal of Herring.
Shoal of Herring. That's yours, is it?
Yeah. I see.
Now, we have a prize for you. And if you look in there in the monitor, you'll be able to see it, because this is a Kallar Kosen gas heater. Now, it may be incongruous to give you this in the present climate, but we on The Late Show always look ahead to when winter comes back again.
I know.
Like next Wednesday
week.
Around 2 o'clock. And that was given to us by Kallar Kosen gas. It's an ardent Tara heater and two bottles of gas to keep you and your lovely sunburned husband warm. And that comes to a total value of about £140. So congratulations to you. All right, there you are. You're the best. Well done. Okay. I have no intention of asking you for any particular song.
Thank
Would you
God.
Sing again for us anyway? Do whatever comes into your mind.
Okay.
Do something else for us. What have you got?
No.
Who, actually, in the course of concerts, who decides what you're going to do?
We all decide.
I do. We all do, actually.
You don't normally have arguments on stage, though, do you? You
no,
do.
Well, it's a consensus.
How do you mean we have arguments on stage?
What are you talking about, arguments?
No, it's a very democratic process.
Yes.
You take votes. We fight, belt each other. After that, it all resolves.
And then they do what I tell them anyway. Paddy.
We'll sing a song that we learned years ago from an old man down in South Tipperary. An old man whose whole life was sweetened by the drinking of punch. It's an old favorite of ours, this song. He growled it out one night to us as the world was slipping out of focus for him. It's a song that starts out very quietly and very poetically. And rapidly deteriorates.
like
St. Patrick's Day. We'd like you to join us in a jug of punch. One pleasant evening in the month of June, as I was sitting with my glass and spoon, a small bird sat on an ivy bunch, and the song he sang was the jug of punch. Do-ra-lo-ra-lo, to-ra-lo-ra-lay, to-ra-lo-ra-lo, to-ra-lo-ra-lay. A small bird sat on an ivy bunch, and the song he sang was the jug of punch. What more diversion can a man desire than to sit and down by a snug turf fire? Upon his knee a pretty wench, aye, and on the table a jug of punch. Do-ra-lo-ra-lo, to-ra-lo-ra-lay, do-ra-lo-ra-lo, to-ra-lo-ra-lay. Upon his knee a pretty wench, and on the table a jug of punch. Let the doctors come with all their art, they'll make no impression upon my heart. Even the cripple forgets his hunch when he's snug outside of a jug of punch. Do-ra-lo-ra-lo, 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 do-ra-lo-ra-lo.
even the cripple forgets his hunch when he's stuck outside of a jug of punch. And if I get drunk, well, the money's me own, and them don't like me, they can leave me alone. I'll tune me fiddle and I'll rosin me bow, and I'll be welcome wherever I go.
Great to have friends in the audience.
It's great to have friends in the audience, indeed. I saw a few of them there joining in. Kieran, you're very welcome. Good evening to you and Donnie. Nice of you to come along. Old friends of the Clancy's. Kieran, just for the serious bit, as they say, for those who weren't around or weren't fully grown, as it were, at the time these fellows started, can you tell us what was it that they did that was so different?
Oh, I was going to reminisce, first of all,
well,
about...
Well, do then, Kieran, about do, and the
first,
then tell me.
The first time I met them as a group when I was in New York in 1962, and they were all down around the village. The Greenwich Village was the place that time. It's not anymore, I don't know. No. But I was up recording old friends, fiddle players, up around Brooklyn and the Bronx, and there was one great old friend of mine named Dennis Murphy, friend of yours, God rest his soul, and another fiddle player named Jerry McCarty, who is now back in Dublin. And I said, uptown, you see, I said, I have to go downtown, down to the village, to meet Clancy Brothers. They said, Greenwich Village? You're not going down there. I said, why? Oh, that's a terrible place of sin. They're all running around in their pelt. Well, I said, it's the month of November in New York, and there's nobody running around in their pelt. And the place, I think, the lads would remember at that time was the Limelight.
That's right.
In Sheridan Square, and across the road in the Lion's Head. But I think you asked me a question, and I think I'll answer this. I've always defended the Clancy's, because people say they have prostituted the old songs. They made the old songs popular to a wider audience at a time when they weren't popular. And when people were sick to the teeth of the 20,000 John McCormacks who were around. Now, John McCormack was great, and I'm doing a program next week in America about John McCormack. But he will never be forgiven for creating the 20,000 imitators. And everybody was sick and tired of these kind of concerts. And they came along and brought a bit of fresh air and brought back the old songs in their own style. People can argue about the way they present the traditional songs, but this was a breath of fresh air in the early beginning of the 1960s, which led a lot of people back to the basic traditional music, which has, well, been so popular ever since.
Of course, terrific, yeah.
Of course, Kieran was the first person to bring us back to Ireland to do a tour.
Were you really, Kieran? Did you make a few bob on it?
No. They made all the money. I'm still a poor man here with my poor wife looking after me. And these fellows made all the money. And if I may, just remember another great friend who, at that time, when we brought the Clancy's back for their first tour, because they were known in America before they were known here, as a group. And I went to the late Jimmy Shields, who, in fact, worked in RT
That's right.
before he died, God rest his soul, formerly had been a manager of the Theatre Royal, and before that manager of Savoy in Limerick. And Jimmy knew the theatre business. And I said, these guys want to come back. Where will we put them? And the Olympia was the first.
And that was in 63, was it?
63, yes.
63, yes. Yes.
And
now, when Kieran says about the songs, lads, where did those songs come from? I know, Tommy, that your mother, of course, had a million songs at her beck and call. Presumably you grew up with music all the time in your house, did you?
I did.
Songs, lads. Where did those songs come from? I know, Tommy, that your mother, of course, had a million songs at her beck and call. Presumably you grew up with music all the time in your house, did you?
I did, yeah. I did all kinds of manoeuvres. In a pipe band, I played a piccolo, and I used to sing with a pop dance band.
The Clippertones.
Clippertones, how do you know that?
Oh, you know all these things. You played piccolo at the same time as working in the garage.
That's right.
Yes.
And I then went to work in a bar. And I was a correspondent for the Armagh Observer. Do anything for a dollar. And that's about what I got. No.
That's right. And your mammy sang all the time in the house.
Oh, she had all kinds. Well, she wouldn't have known a folk song from a hole in the ground.
Yeah.
She just sang songs, and you'd hear her singing anything. I remember she died just a year ago this month, as a matter of fact, Lord mercy her. And when she was dying, you know, she would sing anything, you see, songs that you would want to hear and songs that you wouldn't want to hear at all. She would sing, if somebody a bit rebelly came into the house, she'd sing a good Ireland song as well as she could, and she could do it. And if she would sing the other ones. But a nephew of mine went to visit her, and she thought she should do... She was on her deathbed in a hospital, and she thought she should do something sort of modern for him. So she sang Alexander's Ragtime.
Ah, dear. Irving Berlin to the
fore. Yeah, that was the day before she died.
Dear, oh dear. Dear, oh dear. Now, the other songs then. Was there music in the Clancy household all the time, too?
Yes.
My father was an opera buff, and then in parts of the family, there was an aunt of ours had a house where there was all sort of courtigue, as they call it, you know, singing and dancing. And it was one of those places with no electricity and a sort of a clay floor, but lovely music and lovely songs, and we learned an awful lot of the songs there. At least we heard them and we knew bits of them.
Yes.
We knew bits of a whole lot of folk songs. And later we were able to sort of put together and do some research and get the rest of the words. And very often we had to change them slightly because we were singing them in America. And there's no use in singing songs like about a peeler, for example. Didn't mean anything in America. Then we changed it to policeman. We were accused of corrupting the songs.
The first time that I became aware of the kind of the universality of folk songs was I heard Burl Ives singing Froggy Went A-Courtin' and He Did Ride. And my mother was down in the garden, it was a lovely summer's day, and I went running down to her. I said, Mammy, come up, fella, quick, there's a fella singing your song on the wireless. Because she used to sing, there was a frog lived in the well, hi-ho, said Rolly. Her own, which she had from her own mother, you know. And it was the first inkling that I had that these weren't just our songs, that they travelled all over the place and different people had modified them for their own.
Ronnie, how are you? Good evening to you. You're very welcome, and the rest of ye. Ronnie, could you put into words what these fellas meant for you?
Well, the first week after I got married, Tom paid me rent.
Why, Ronnie?
I think it was a fiver.
Why so, Ronnie, may we ask?
I hadn't got the fiver. And there's an awful lot of stories we could tell, but it didn't happen in coffee shops, so we mightn't bear repeating. And not many good stories happened in coffee shops anyway.
But musically, Ronnie, I was striving for. Musically, could you suggest to us what they meant to you?
Well, I'd heard about them. I'd been in America. And I was singing in the Gay Theatre with John Malloy at the time. And I got this terrible job. I had to sing, instead of playing records in between the acts of a play, I had to go out in front and sing songs, like long songs, like, Rocks a Bon and things like that, you know, 22 verses, come back next Tuesday for the rest of it, you know what I'm saying? And I got this job, and I was jealous of these heads over in America getting all these readies for singing, and I was getting £6 a week, and having to pay readies out of it as well, you know. So, anyway, I went to see them in 63 when they came here first, and it was great. And the first meeting we had with them was Barney and myself and I don't think you were in the group, John, that time.
No, it was only the Prince.
Poor old Luke. I say poor old Luke, Lord, my gentlemen, all that. We're all there in Ceiriúnán. And we all arrived in Carrigan Shore, and this show that John Molloy was running, Dennis Franks was the tour manager. And we arrived in Carrigan Shore, and people were staying away from this gig in the hundreds.
Millions.
And we arrived in Carrigan Shore, and they were staying away even more than in the hundreds. Like. So we all went to Dunmore's, all the lads and ourselves. And Kieran Burke and I said, now, we better not drink much today on account of this gig tonight, you see. And we didn't drink much. That time we could drink us up. We had 4 pints each, I remember. So we all came back. And John Molloy was delighted we were all showing signs of gaggle, you see, so he could close down the show and he wouldn't have to pay anybody. So Barney said, who was drunk? I said, I'll climb up that thing, that pole. It was a... What do you call them things?
It was television mast.
Yeah. In the middle of the town. It wasn't television that time. It was a radio.
It was an ESB.
An ESB pole. Yeah, yeah. And Barney shot. Who was drunk? And Barney climbed up to the top of it and began combing his hair in the top, you see. By which time we'd gathered all the inhabitants of Carrigan Shore and Carrigbeg and the whole lot. They were all over to see us, you see. And Barney gets down, and he wouldn't get down, and he'd please promise not to arrest him. So we got down, and both sides of the street were lined up and clapping, you see. They all clapped outside, so John said, yous are all sacked. And we were all sacked, and we all went off the lads, and we had a few more.
We went back to Carter's house here.
Carter's there.
Would you ever do us a little bar as a tribute to the lads? Would you ever stand up there and do a sort of I'll go on, do. Up here. Up here, lads. Stand up here in the centre where we can see and hear you. Up here. Come on. No, here will do fine. Yeah, yeah. Here. Yeah, why not? Down there. That'd be that, anywhere around there. Give us a shout or something.
Give us one of the ones we stole from you. You know, they're looking... They're leaving a Liverpooler.
They're looking as if they weren't expecting it, you see, and they all brought their instruments and everything. He might do. Well, Paddy, will you join in? Come on, join in here, Paddy. Come on, join in. Paddy Riley, ladies and gentlemen, just stand up and give yourself. Come on, join in. Come on, good. Very good. Don't collapse.
Fine.
Very good.
Oh, there was an old woman and she lived in the wood. We'll warn ya.
wouldn't doubt you, Ronnie.
All right, Tommy Makem. All right, then. Now, where are we? Oh, yes, I have to give another clue here, don't I? Is this the musical one? Oh, no, it's not. No, this is number three. All right, then. Number three. Oh, I gave... No, I didn't give three. I beg your pardon. No, I didn't give three. I beg... Number three coming up, then. Number three clue. All right, you ready? Here it is. I live in Britain, where I have my home, but I'm really quite Irish, as you might have known. All right? That's number three. We'll take a break now, all right? And we'll come back to you in a few moments with the next part of the show. See you then. Thank you very much indeed, ladies and gentlemen. All right. All right. Now. First of all, the news for you two is that Mr. Hackett of the National Manpower Service rang to say there must have been a communication breakdown about the two people in the audience, and he will set matters right first thing on Monday morning. Who says politicians don't have influence? First thing Monday morning. Now, number four clue coming up. Are you ready? This is a musical clue. You standing by, Tommy?
You are? Of course.
Okay, hold on. Here it is. Eliza and Henry fought quite a bit. She's no help, but the professor might clinch it. I thought you did that beautifully, Tommy. I really do.
Thank you. Think of what beautiful. It's going to cost you.
And there's, you'll be lucky. And there's one clue yet to go. But first of all, I have to say that there is a young couple in the audience joining us tonight. Anne Harvey, Barbara and Stephen Coughlin. I beg your pardon, that's Anne Harvey. Barbara and Stephen Coughlin, is that yourselves?
Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, God, you're very dark up there. I can't see you at all. Maybe you just want to stay out of the limelight. This young couple, ladies and gentlemen, proposed. He proposed to her and she proposed. No, you proposed to him, didn't you? That's right. She proposed to him on the radio program on Valentine's Day. On the radio program, on one more. And he said yes. And then she said yes. And it did go all right, did it?
It did, yes.
Excellent. Thanks.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
And right. How long are you married now?
4 weeks today.
4 weeks. Well, who's counting? Yes. And it's going all right. It's going nice, isn't it? Now. Now, as everybody in the audience will know, once you get married, you settle in, as it were, and you sort of become lazy, and you don't go out as much as usual, and then she feeds you very well, and you make food for her, and you sit around, and you don't get any exercise. So, in view of the fact that that will happen to you, like all good married people, we are giving you two membership cards to the Tivoli Health and Leisure Centre. There you will have for yourselves a year's membership. You will have a fully equipped gymnasium, aerobic studio, fully supervised creche, well, never know, a lovely jacuzzi, a pool, a team of qualified instructors and all of that, a membership card for each one of you. They're on Tunliff Road.
Thank
and we
you
hope you
much.
Enjoy yourself and use it well, all right? Congratulations to you. Very good. All right. Now, we are still being inundated with requests, and we've taken a democratic vote in the studio. Didn't we take a democratic vote?
Yes.
And it fell to the lot of Tommy to sing The Cobbler.
Guys.
Oh, my name is Dick Darby, I'm a cobbler. I serve in my time at the old camp. Some call me an old agitator, but now I'm resolved to repent. With me ing twing of an ing thing of an idle. With me ing twing of an ing thing of an idle. With me roo boo boo roo boo boo randy. And my lapstone keeps beating away. Now my father was hung for sheep stealing. My mother was born for a witch. My sister's a dandy housekeeper. And I'm a mechanical switch. With me ing twing of an ing thing of an idle. With me ing twing of an ing thing of an idle. With me roo-boo-boo-roo-boo-boo-randy, and me lapstone keeps beating away. And my wife, she is humpy, she's lumpy. My wife, she's the devil, she's cracked. And no matter what I may do with her, her tongue, it goes clickety-clack. With me ing-twing of an ing-thing of an idle. with me ing twing of an ing thing of an idiot, with me roo-boo-boo-roo-boo-boo randy, and me lobstone keeps bitten away. It was early one fine summer's morning, a little before it was day, I dipped her three times in the river and carelessly bade her good day. With me ing twing of an ing thing of an night oath, with me ing twing of an ing thing of an night, with me roo boo boo roo boo boo randy, and me lobstone keeps bitten away.
Tommy, as a matter of interest, riddle me this. Where did that song come from?
I learned it from a woman called Mary Toner, who lived down the street from us. She kept a little sweetie shop. Her husband was a bread man and a hunts man, Joe, and she had a book of songs that she had written out by hand when she was a young girl. She worked as a servant girl in a pub in the town, and she liked the songs. But there was a great connection between her family and my family, because her family were the Kellys, who owned a mill in Derry Noose, and all the Kellys were magnificent step dancers. I saw Ned Kelly, when he was 94, step dancing at a wedding. Fantastic dancers. And he told me that the sign of a good dancer at that time was that you would get a girl out to face you at a party, and any good dancer had to be able to kick her apron over her head on the last step of the dance. An awful lot of accidents, but if you were a good dancer, you didn't disturb anything except the apron, and he could do it. Yeah. But the Kellys always danced, and my father and his brother, they worked in the mill for the Kellys, but they used to play the music for them. They played fiddles and flutes and things.
It's a most unusual little song, isn't it?
Yes, and she told me that when she was a young girl, when she went to the parties where she got it first, there were two old men that used to sing it, and when they'd be asked to sing, I don't know whether they're brothers or not, they used to get two stools and sit in the middle of the floor and face each other, and some girl would kick off her two shoes, and they would take a shoe apiece and hold it between their knees, and they'd do the sewing, the two men facing each other.
Yeah. And did she teach you how to do the action?
She taught me how to do that, yeah. She was great.
What a lovely story. That's
I remember one night in Carnegie Hall, we had sung that, or Tommy had sung it so often, the audience came to expect it, and we decided we'd play a trick on him. And he announced the cobbler, a big round of applause, of course. Tommy walked off the stage, and Paddy and Tom and I sat up, the three of us.
And we did it.
That is the other extraordinary thing, that so many of your songs, as soon as you start to sing them, everybody joins in. I mean, this must happen regularly in America and so on, wherever you go.
You know, it was so extraordinary, Dave, when Tommy did come to America, and I met Tommy for the first time in America, and you were asking earlier about where did we get the songs or how did they come about. It was so strange that Tommy seemed to know all the same songs that I knew when I was young. And I'm sure Tommy had somewhat of the same experience with us. We somehow or other had learned a lot of these songs here when we were in Ireland when we were young.
Yes, but they were songs that were ignored by the young people.
Oh my God.
They were all rubbish.
I tell you why, they were songs that were associated with poverty.
Is that what it was?
Ah, yes.
Yeah.
And when we realized during the folk boom in America that people were asking us to sing songs, we were kind of embarrassed not knowing any. And initially very timid about singing the songs that we did know. And they got such a tremendous response that we began to stick the shoulders back and sing them out and get a bit of blackguarding into them, as we say.
And get paid for it.
That too. Yeah. But I think that the success of the songs for us was very much a part of the American thing. That nobody in America really is embarrassed about anything. And none of the connotations of poverty that might have been attached to the songs in Ireland were there. And when we came back to Ireland singing them, the people here, that thing was infectious. They began to listen to us and say, if they can sing them, God, we can sing.
We can all do that. My mother used to sing that. Joe Kennedy, good evening to you. You're very welcome. So what was your association now with the lads in the early days, Joe?
Well, I was working on a paper, not the Evening Press, where I am now, and I'd heard Ciarán playing records. I was interested in the music, and from years, early years. And when they came to Ireland, there was a newspaper interview, and a number of us went along to talk to them. And I had remember meeting Liam 10 years beforehand, or 15 years beforehand, at an interview for a job in an insurance company, the Zurich Insurance Company in Dawson Street.
You too, Joe.
Yeah, okay, there was a line of us waiting outside, and Mr. Deal was the boss.
Too?
Yeah.
Not in that particular one.
No, but yet. Anyway... Mr. Clancy got the job. He had 7 honours in his leaving cert.
So who got it? There. Liam Clancy got the job in the Zurich Insurance. A good company.
But he didn't stay very long. I think it drove him crazy, and he started taking acting lessons in Brendan Smith or something like that. And he went off collecting folk songs and went to America with Tommy Makem. But then he came back, like famous 10 years later or whatever, and I went along to talk to him and with other newspaper people. And we just kept in touch, and... it was a sensational thing at the time, what they did. It influenced a lot of young people. I was about 28 at the time, it's a long time ago, but younger people, much younger than me, became influenced by what they were doing, and it brought out a lot of talent in young people who perhaps it never would have happened.
That's right.
And also, which is very important folk singers in this country whom we've never listened to or paid any attention to, such as Seamus O'Haney, and even Seamus Ennis, although he was on radio and a household name. Younger people listen to them for the first time. Liam Clancy, when I started to talk to him, I always remember this. He said, "What are you doing wasting your time talking to me? You should be talking to Joe Heaney." I said, "Who's Joe Heaney?" So I said, "Come on and listen to him." So he took me up to O'Donoghue's, and Joe Heaney was sitting in the corner, and he started to sing. And this was a different type of music altogether. I'd never heard anything like it in my life before, but it was terrific stuff, you know. They did this. This was a very good thing to do, I think, from a folklore point of view, apart from the commercial.
I think, Joe, also many people don't realise that by doing what they did, and they did it happenschance and serendipity and all of those words, that's a word you wouldn't know, by doing what they did, they paved the way for all of those groups who came along.
That's true.
Up to and including Horslips and Clannad and all of those.
The talent was there, but it was encouraged to come out, I think. Heaven knows what would have happened. I don't know what would have happened if they hadn't broken through an old mould, as Ciarán was talking about earlier.
Yes,
you know, Mother McCree and all that sort of stuff. You know?
That was Irish music. In
that
America
was it.
Then,
yeah, does your mother come from Ireland?
And Lochinvar and so on. Yeah. There's a lady of the audience wanted to know, how did Tommy meet you? How did you become involved with him?
We met. there was a lady called Deanne Hamilton, was coming over to Ireland to collect folk songs, and Paddy and Tom had known her in New York, and she was going to visit their home in Carrick-on-Shore, and she was coming up to collect songs from my mother. And Liam was down there, and she had called at the Clancy home, and Liam came up to Katie with her, carrying big recording machines. You know, you'd need a horse to haul them along. And she brought them in, and he and I met then, and we went off to a Cayley in the town hall in Newry. And I remembered well, the McCusker Brothers Cayley Band were playing, and the McCusker brothers are all from Katie as well, from Katie area. There were 9 brothers of them in the Cayley band. And they were playing at the Cayley, and one of them asked me to sing a song. So I said, "Surely to God." And I got up on the stage, and there was great noise because it was a Cayley and a dance.
Well, to finish that part of the story, because you can't really say it yourself, or you'd be boasting. But I never felt sorrier for anybody than I did for Tommy, because nobody, listen, he sat there and I thought, what is he going to do? And he put up his foot and he started doing the actions for the cobbler, and the wave of silence spread back from the first row back to the last row in this rowdy place. And when he had absolute silence, he broke into the song. You know, that was our first meeting.
That took nerve. That's what you have. Hard neck.
That was
neck.
Me. Well, you needed it in those days.
Sure neck.
You need it today as well.
Next question from somebody in the audience. Why did you actually break up, all of ye? Who's going to answer that one?
I think, you know, it wasn't a conscious breaking up. At one point, we had been singing for 10 years, doing approximately 200 concerts a year, traveling all over the world. And we were getting to the point where we had to stop. we were definitely thinking of stopping singing altogether. Tommy said, about a year from now, what I'd like to do is go out on my own. And we said, fine. He gave us years' notice. We didn't know that we were going to carry on after Tommy had left. But we did stop for a while. And then Tommy went off on his own. There was no rows. We still love Tommy, don't we, Tommy?
You see the knife marks in my back.
And it was a mutual agreement. Yeah. And Paddy and Liam and I went off and sang with our brother Bobby, and then the Furies came along, and then different people joined the group, and we were...
Louis Killen.
If we had all the Clancy Brothers, Louis Killen, Clancy Brothers, Fury Brothers, Clancy Brothers, the whole thing.
Yeah.
And that kept on going.
And Tom, you now live in Carrick on Shore?
No, I live in California.
Sorry, Paddy.
I live in
Carrick on Shore. With a few cattle.
That's right.
God between us and all harm.
Got a few old cows, yeah.
Yeah. And you're happy doing that?
Reasonably.
Yeah.
And he doesn't live with a cattle, he lives with his wife. <who's here. laughs>
Indeed, yeah. And you, Tom, live where now?
I live in California. In a little town, it just became a city. They become cities after a while. It's called Agoura. And it's near a place that you might know the name, called Malibu. My children go to school in Malibu, at a Catholic school there. Yeah. And I work in the studios in Hollywood.
Doing
what? I do television and movies.
Yeah. All of that sort of
commercials.
Yeah, I see. And then how long are you two going to do your thing?
Who, Tommy and I?
Yeah.
I have no intention of stopping at all.
And you know, Paddy and I have been doing...
the same way? Sorry,
Paddy and I have been doing concerts in America with our nephew, Robbie O'Connell.
Yes.
And we made an album just this last year with our brother Bobby.
I see.
So it's now the Clancy Brothers and Robbie O'Connell.
I see. And out of the Avery Fisher concert on the 20th of May will come an album as well as the film and all of that.
Yes, we hopefully.
We hope an album as well as the film, yeah.
Very good, yes. All right, now, how long... Yes, you told me once a story of going to a wake in New York, Liam. Just tell me that again, because I've forgotten the details of it. Just
that was a funny story. Well,
it's a true story.
Yes.
All funny stories are true stories, but poor Grania didn't realize... She was an actress in New York, and she had married an actor, and she didn't realize that he was gay. If you'll pardon the expression. You have to get used to it.
Over there, and Gabriel.
Over the years. But he didn't have much time for Grania. He loved walking his poodle down by the down by the Hudson River.
Yes.
And that was what he spent his time doing. I don't know who he met on his round. But anyway, he died.
Yes.
And Grania decided, in his will or whatever, he said that he wanted to be cremated, and he wanted to have his ashes scattered at midnight over his beloved Hudson River, down where he used to walk the beloved poodle. And we were invited to the wake. It was a strange kind of a wake. I remember Tom coming in and saying, "Where is he?" We just come up from the limelight up in Greenwich Village, and Tom was feeling no pain. And she said, "There he is." And there was this little package on the mantelpiece, you know.
Wee box.
And his ashes were in it. And the wake was a bit dry for a while. But it very quickly livened up, I remember. And 12 o'clock came and went. And we were all in the throes of a great sing-song. And about 2 o'clock in the morning, somebody said to Grania, "What about his last wish of being scattered over the Hudson?" And Grania had had a few drinks herself, went into the John, lifted up the seat, put the ashes down, flushed it, and she said, "The bastard will be in the Hudson in about 10 minutes.
Nice. We gotta finish. We can't say all the things we'd like to say to you, but we'd just like to say thank you for all the years of entertainment and music. Good luck in New York on the 20th
if you need it.
And you're a great bunch of fellas. And finish with your song. go on, finish with yourself. Well, here we go.
We'll sing one that everybody can join us
That's
in.
Right. Here we go now. I wonder what it will
it says
be.
Says the summertime is coming and the trees are sweetly blooming.
Yes.
It doesn't rain. Will you go, lassie, go?
Oh, the summer time is coming, and the trees are sweetly blooming, and the wild mountain tide rolls around the blooming heather. Will you go, lassie?
Paddy Riley, would you sing it out?
And we'll all go to pluck wild mountain thyme all around the glowing heather. Will you go, lassie?
I will build my love a bower near yon fountain, and on it I will pile all the flowers of the mountain. Will you go, lassie?
Let's hear.
And we'll all go together to pluck wild mountain thyme all around the blooming heather. Will you go, lassie, go?
If my true love she were gone, I would surely find another, where wild mountain thyme grows around the blooming heather. Will you go, lassie, go?
And we'll all go together to pluck wild mountain thyme all around the blooming heather. Will you go, lassie?
It's too nice to stop there. Let's start from the beginning.
Oh, the summer time is coming.
The trees are sweetly blooming.
And the trees are sweetly blooming.
And the wild mountain thyme.
And the wild mountain thyme
grows around the blooming heather.
Grows around the blooming heather. Will you go, lassie? Go.
We'll all go together.
And we'll all go together to pluck wild mountain thyme all around the blooming heather. Will you go, lassie, go?
We gotta go. Bad cess to them, they've run us out of time, so they have. Who else? Last clue coming up. It reads, lucky breaks my common pockets, but I don't wait, I move like a rockets. Okay? Lucky breaks my common pockets, but I don't wait, I move like a rockets. First post Thursday morning, postcards only, please. No late, late show next week. Eurovision Song Contest instead. Ladies and gentlemen, our thanks to the Clancy Brothers and Tommy Makem. Thank you, brothers. Well done, boys. Well done. Good night to you, and thank you very much. Well done. Thank you.
It was unheard of.
Yeah.
At that time. Wearing the iron sweaters, of course. Yeah. And within the following week, we heard that the sale of iron sweaters jumped 700%.
Now, to give an idea of how, you know, there's 40 million people used to watch that show. And we were around New York, and at that time, our following was folk music people, not Irish, necessarily. Or very few Irish.
Very few Irish, yeah.
But once we got on the Ed Sullivan Show, it's like any blessing from the Pope at that time. He was looked up to by all the Irish.
Like
something, something like the Late Night Show, indeed. I was just about to say.
And when the following day after that, we went out to Chicago, and Tom and I were walking down the street looking for a place to stay. And there was fellas, now we hadn't been in Chicago before. Fellas saw us, they probably recognized the sweaters over our shoulders. And they said, hi, boys, you did a great show last night. Tom turned around to me and said, hey, We're famous.
Well, then I knew Dick, when we had it made, because we used to go to a place called the White Horse Tavern on Hudson Street. And we'd be singing in there, and old Ernie, who was an old German man who owned the place, didn't allow singing. But every once an hour he'd come in and say, no singing allowed in here. So everybody would stop, and then we went out to the bar, they would start to sing again. And there was a woman upstairs kept complaining. And the police would come over from the 10th, was the 10th precinct? Yeah. And they all knew us, and they would come in and they would start and sing along with us and say, you're making a lot of noise. There's a woman complaining upstairs, and then they would go up and tell her off for complaining. So after we did the Ed Sullivan Show, she had apparently been watching it, because the following day, Monday, she came into the White Horse and she said, are those the fellas that do all that singing every night and making all that noise? And he said, yeah. I said, well, I saw them on the Eds. They can sing all they want.
That's sanctioned. Dick, what is your association with these fellas, or if any? Or
I live on the other side of New York City.
Yeah. Is that about it? Were you always a fan of theirs?
I'd say I was, yes. And I think...
he was a babby.
1958, I was eight. Yeah. A bit more interested in football at the time, but I think it's fair to say they left a big impression.
Yes.
As they set off on that journey.
Yes, ambassadors of song throughout the world. Oh, listen, yes. I know that you have to go to Kerry.
Sure.
May we thank you very much indeed for joining us, and I know you're in a rush down there. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Dick Spring. Thank you very much. All right, truly. Has a long journey ahead of him. All right, lads, sing a song, Kevin. So don't just sit there. Sing a song, for heaven's
you know,
sake. You must know another
song. They always pick on me to sing the quiet, nice, gentle little love song. Give me a key there, Willie. Yeah. Oh, when I was a little boy, so my mother told me, come away, haul away, we'll haul away, Joe. But if I did not kiss the girls, my lips would all grow moldy, come away, haul away, we'll haul away, Joe. Away, haul away. Ship now is rolling, come away, haul away, we'll haul away, Joe. Now first I met a Yankee girl, and she was fat and lazy, come away, haul away, we'll haul away, Joe. And then I met an Irish girl, she damn near drove me crazy, come away. Way, haul away, we'll haul away, Joe. St. Patrick was a gentleman, he came from decent people, tell me. Way, haul away, we'll haul away, Joe. He built a church in Dublin town, and on it put a steeple, tell me. Way, haul away, we'll haul away, Joe. No way, haul away, we're bound for better weather. Come way, haul away, we'll haul away, Joe.
Now, wouldn't that remind you of O'Donoghue's pub?
Don't fool me.
I see Maureen and Paddy over there.
You've been rehearsing. Is that Maureen and Paddy? Good day to you, ladies and gentlemen. You're very welcome indeed. You were good friends to this lot in their day, were you not?
Yes.
She fed us, for God's sake.
Did she have to?
No.
Not really.
She not only fed us, but I remember coming back from a tour of England and she took every penny that I'd made on the tour.
Oh!
Why? She kept it in the back room and she'd only give me... She was afraid I'd spend it all.
Or lose
Wasn't
it.
Wasn't she right?
Or lose it.
Wasn't
or
she right?
Robbed.
That's perfectly
Indeed,
true,
right?
though.
So she'd give me a few bob at
true.
A time.
Yeah.
She was a mother and father to us.
Like a mammy indeed. Now, Liam and Paddy, or Tom and Paddy, you went first of all to America when?
1947.
Yes. And how did you go?
We went, wow, that's a lovely story.
We went by ship.
We were in England, in London, and we decided that we were going to get out. It was cold, miserable. And the rations were on 1947 in the spring. It was a bad winter. So we decided we were going to leave, but where to go? We decided that it was going to be either Australia, Canada, or America, if we could. So we tossed the coin and it came down Canada. Now, where were we going to go in Canada? We didn't know anybody there. So we got a map of Canada, and they gave me a pin and blindfolded me, and I stuck the pin down. It landed in Toronto. So then we had to find a way to get there. The American GI brides were all leaving England at that time, and they were being shipped over to the United States in troop ships.
You're not going to tell me.
And we got on one of the troop ships called the SS Marine Flasher with 400 GI brides.
It was what? It was called what?
The SS Marine Flasher.
Flasher, they're all.
And how many fellas were on, as well as you?
Paddy and I, and a fella called Pat Casey, and a couple of other sailors.
And how many women were on it?
400.
And it cost us £28. For the fare, that is.
One way.
9 months later, there were 200 children born. That woman has got to be stopped.
By the way, that went from Southampton to New York.
Has got to be stopped.
By the way, that went from Southampton to New York.
Yes.
And then we had to get from there to Toronto by train. We had a transit visa only for America. We couldn't get into the States. That is why, really, we were going to Canada. But when we got off the train in Canada, in Toronto, everybody got off and got into taxis and people kissing, meeting each other, and off they went. And the three of us, Pa Casey and Tom and I, were left standing there in the railway station. We had no address. We had nowhere to go.
And how much money did you have?
We had something just under $100
between you.
Yes. No.
Oh, each.
About $250.
Oh, that's pretty good. Come on.
But well, we had a sway. We were looking at the rest of our lives and somewhere to live and something to eat. We had no source of income and knew nobody who could ever get us.
So there you were in the station anyway.
Yeah, and Tom went in for a haircut.
And a shave. Yes. And a shoe shine.
And Pat Casey watched the bags, and I walked out, and there was a street that way and a street that way, and I went straight up the street. Didn't care which way I went. I mean, that was a decision. I could have gone either way. Went straight up and found a hotel, went in, asked him if they had a room, mind you, with enough accommodation for three fellas, two of being brothers. That made it very important to say that, because then we could get a double bed, you see, for Tom and I, and a single bed for Casey.
Casey didn't like to sleep with us.
So we got a bed there for the night, and the following day we went out and got jobs and digs, and we learned how to live in North America. We never looked back.
And then we got into the United States through two aunts. Aunt Mariana and Kathy were in Cleveland, and we found their address. And we got on a bus and got down to Cleveland, Ohio, and they sponsored us into the United States.
Yeah.
So at least we gotten over the border.
Yeah.
And then off we went from there.
There's a fella in Katy asked me one time, "What would it take me to America?" I said, "Oh, about 80 or 90 pounds." He said, "For God's sake, about 80 or 90 pounds, I wouldn't be going to America."
Now, when did the Plough and the Stars come? That fantastic excursion into show business and theatrical entrepreneurialship.
I'm sorry,
I got into that.
Well, when we got into Cleveland, Ohio, I started working in the Cleveland Playhouse at nighttime. I was a welder making bicycles in the daytime. And in the nighttime, I started acting. And I got to know a bit about the acting. And I didn't know anything about welding either. That's another story. And then we went into New York. And from New York, we both came over to Ireland in 1949, Christmas. And I got a job with Geoffrey Kendall and his Shakespeareana International company.
I don't believe it.
And, at the Theatre Isle in Waterford for £2.10 a week. Paid in half a crowns, cash from the box office. And I spent 9 months with him learning Shakespeare. We used to do 5 Shakespeare plays a week. And on Saturday night, we'd do Arms and the Man by Shaw. And on Sunday, we do Dracula.
Tom,
Dracula would do you.
This is completely by the way, but what was your best Shakespearean role?
I really don't know. One of the things I loved doing was that there were so many parts that I could do in Hamlet. And I do Francisco, and then I go
Polonius,
and I get back. I was doing the churlish priest and the gravedigger, which was a neat trick because they were both in the same scene. As the gravedigger would finish, hey, pickaxe and a spade, do the whole scene. I get out of the grave under the stage, come back up with the cloak on. Our obsequies have been as far in love.
He does it well, doesn't he? All you had to do was add Yorick to that now and you had a trio going straight away.
But after that, anyway, we went back to the United States.
Yes.
Paddy sent me £60 in Ballybunion, County Kerry, for my fare. And I went back over on the Mauritania. And we got together again in Cleveland, came back into New York, and Paddy said to me, I was in a play. Paddy said, that play's not very...
Gentlemen, I want you to pay attention, because what you're going to see is a bit of history in the making, and it's something that you're not going to see again. Our next 4 guests in the early 60s were undoubtedly the most famous 4 Irishmen in the world. They came together from Carrick-on-Shore and Quay de County Armagh to sing songs that generations of Irish people had neglected, and they had lain dormant for generations. And in singing those songs, they sang their way into the hearts of millions of people right across the world, but particularly in America, as well as the UK, and here in Ireland. And not only that, but they paved the way for a whole host of other people to do something similar in music. In the way of all good groups, after 12, 13 years in the business, they split up and they went their separate ways. And they are coming together for the first time in 15 years to do a show in the Lincoln Center in New York on May the 20th. Now, it's a beautiful place, the Lincoln Center, the Avery Fisher Hall, and it seats 3,000 people. And the booking opened last week. The show is not until the 20th of May, and already, we heard today, it is booked out to capacity, not a seat left, which will give you some idea of the measure of popularity that they have in the United States. 15 years later, they are coming together for that, and 15 years later, they are coming together on the Late Late Show tonight. So when you welcome them, you are welcoming, literally, a living legend of music, if I can put it that way. Would you welcome, please, the Clancy Brothers and Tommy Makem.
Please her, and I'm the boy to tease her. I'm the boy can squeeze her, and I'll tell you what they'll do. I'll hold for life an Irish rabbit, a brogue, and Barney too, as they come. And you're rolling and stalling and holling and rolling and pound on the hue.
Well, here I am from Paddy's land, the land of fire and town. I broke the hearts of all the girls for miles from Kitty Town. And when they hear that I'm away, they'll raise a hullabaloo. When they hear about that handsome lad, that they'll follow them. As her other heavy dude. No more she'd have the handsome lad that they followed on the hoo.
For I'm the boy to please her, and I'm the boy to tease her. I'm the boy to squeeze her, and I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll go to like an Irish man of the broken blarney to his me rollick and stollick and hollick and hollick and fall down on the hoo.
I hear that Queen Victoria has a daughter fine and brown. Perhaps she'd take it into her head for to marry an Irish man. And if I could only get the chance to have a word or two, I'd soon she'd take a notion in the bowl o' Dunahoo.
Or I'm the boy to please her.
Sit down there, for heaven's sake, and make yourselves comfortable. Oh, I see, the Von...
There's life in the old bones yet.
The Von Yeans are coming off already, are they?
You're bloody right, or else you'd be taking me out of here in a sponge.
That's right, can't stick the heat, huh? I knew you were weak fellas all the same. There's no doubt about it, for four actors, you can certainly turn out a song.
Thank you.
Let's start at the basics. Why are you coming together again, pray, after so long?
Who's going to answer that?
Go ahead, Liam.
I'm the closest. Basically, we're getting together to do a film of a kind of a documentary history of the group before we all become too antique. And we were getting back together in Ireland to do some of the filming. The film will culminate at Avery Fisher Hall on the 20th of May. We should get a load to come over, as a matter of fact, it'd be great. But we'll be filming down the country, down in Carrick, and taking Tommy back to Katie. And you very kindly gave us a reason for all coming together ahead of time. And here we are.
It is a notion that we had about 2 years ago on the Late Late Show, but you weren't of a mind to do it then. But now you are. And how long will you stay together this time? Is it just for that one show, or do you...
God willing.
Well, we're just going to do that one big show in New York, and you never know. We might be doing a show here in Ireland if, if we're offered enough money.
Do you mean if you're made to feel
that's
welcome?
Right.
Like, I see. And what about Australia and Britain and places of
it
that?
It could happen.
Ah,
very
Tom,
far away.
Yes, I thought
but
so.
But it's a little doubtful.
We haven't really
thought about that. We don't think that far ahead.
Did you never think that far ahead?
Oh, we were in Australia several times.
Oh, I know.
Did we think that far ahead of doing shows in different countries?
Yeah.
I think it'd be lovely, but I can't get these fellas to agree to it.
As far as thinking ahead, when we first took our first engagement out in Chicago in 1958 at a little club called the Gate of Horn, we sat down and wondered among ourselves if we should abandon
we had a mass meeting, all four of us.
If we should abandon our various careers to go out and do this thing.
Yeah.
And we decided at the time, the hell with it, we'll give it 6 months. That was in 1958. So here we are.
Still doing
it. It's gone on and on and on. One never knows.
Now that I see Tommy removing the Bonnie and sweater, would somebody tell me something that I wanted to know for a long time? How did the Bonnie and sweater bit start?
We had a manager who saw him, a good Jewish boy from New York. he saw us walking in one very wintry day with him to a rehearsal, and he said, that's what you'll wear, because we couldn't decide. We had white shirts and
how we got them gay is our mother, the Clancy's mother, sent over three of them to Willie, Paddy and I.
Yeah.
And I had bought one out of Martin Standen's in Galway.
Right. Uh-huh. Yeah.
Martin, there's a plug for you.
83 years later.
Very good.
And
we wore them. It was winter time.
Yes.
And our manager saw them and he said, that's what I want. I want something to show that you're from Ireland, etc. And
it's what they call in the business now, packaging.
Right.
He was looking for a package to put us in, you know.
He was a smart boy, wasn't he?
But they were very unusual at that time, Gay. I mean, very few people had them. I mean, I remember wearing one and people saying, where'd you get it? It looks lovely, you know. Is it Norwegian or something?
Do you ski?
In fact, we were going to do a concert in some place in Connecticut one time, and we got into this taxi, and we had the sweaters tied around our necks, you know. And Tom was looking very burly, and we were talking. The taxi driver kept looking over his shoulder at us. And the address where we were doing the concert was at a gym, you see?
Stadium.
Yeah. Yeah. And he said, you guys are wrestlers or something? he could have been, right?
There was a wrestling team going to do a match at the university in Connecticut that day.
Russian wrestlers.
Yeah, because Gorgeous George was on the train with us. You remember Gorgeous
George? Oh, yes, with the blonde. I remember that. The fellow with the big blonde head of hair and so on.
Tell me this, lads. Now, we've all heard about the Ed Sullivan Show. I'll be darting around the place tonight trying to figure out how it all started and how it came all together and so on. But the Ed Sullivan Show was the cruncher, wasn't
it? That's right.
Yes. Tell me about that now. When was it, first of all?
When was it?
1961. Yes.
Yeah.
We were playing down in Greenwich Village in a club called One Sheridan Square with the famous jazz singer, Josh White, blues guitarist and singer. And his manager was a Jewish New York manager who spotted what we were about, but couldn't figure out how he was going to fit us into the business.
Was this Marty?
This Marty, the early man.
Yeah.
So he mulled this over. He figured that we had talent, that there was some kind of excitement there, and he didn't know how to utilize it. So he decided he would put us into an uptown club called the Blue Angel, which is a very, very fancy place. It was one of those places where the walls, instead of wallpaper or paint, they had mattresses on them.
They were upholstered.
You know, nobody in the entire place spoke English.
Not even ourselves.
I remember one night, Ava Gardner sitting there, and the manager another night came to us and says, "Gentlemen, please no rebel songs tonight. Edward and Mrs. Simpson are out front."
And they couldn't speak English either.
But they had a good grace to leave before we started doing our thing. But in putting us in there was a kind of a stepping stone onto the Ed Sullivan Show. And that's where the packaging came in.
Yes.
He didn't know what we could wear because we looked like terrible slobs.
Yeah.
And when he saw the four sweaters, he said, "That's it. That's it. That's what you're going to wear."
But now...
That's what you're going
to
wear.
But now, to come on to the Ed Sullivan...
The actual show, yeah.
That place was a place where the Ed Sullivan Talent Scouts went to see new talent. And they came there when we were there one night. Jack Dempsey and Jim Downey and the man from the Ed Sullivan Show. And they came and asked us right then and there if we'd do some of the Ed Sullivan Show. But it was the kind of a place now that our manager, Marty Ehrlichman, had another client... that he asked us if we would allow his client to do one of the sets for half an hour in the middle of instead of us. We said, surely, you know. And she was a very pretty girl, and she went on and she did some beautiful songs, and her name was Barbara Streisand. Well, and so she, of course, became very famous, and we lost our manager.
When you say she was a very pretty girl, I remember distinctly Marty Ehrlichman says, "This chick," he said, "that I've got is going to be the next Judy Garland, if I can get her to have a nose job."
Well, even with that. But what happened on the actual Ed Sullivan Show, which was a showcase for talent on television and so on?
Well, we went up on the Sunday to do it, and we were to do two songs. And when Ed Sullivan came on and saw us, he sort of liked us. And there was somebody supposed to be on another act, supposed to be on the show, and they didn't show up or something happened. And instead of getting somebody else, he expanded our section on.
And how many did you
get? He asked us to improvise an extra 15 minutes. So and we ended up with an unprecedented 18 or 20 minutes on the show. Which
very much good, is it, Tom? And I said, no. He said, why don't you do a good play? I said, what'll I do? He said, why don't you do O'Casey's Plowing the Stars? And I said, I will, if you'll design the scenery. I'll direct it. We'll put it on. We've pulled our money. We got another fella to put in a couple of $100. What was his name?
Noel Ben.
And we called it Trio Productions. We took over a theater, the Cherry Lane Theater in New York.
What did he know about set design?
Nothing. He knew to tell me how to do it.
Go on.
He was my advisor.
So you did the Plow?
We did the Plow and the Stars, and we got Sean O'Casey to agree to let us do it for so much money through the Madden Play Company. He gave us his blessing. He wrote a letter to me. I should have kept it.
Oh, dear.
Who knows? But anyway, we thought we'd put it on. We put it on for about $600 or $700, and in 21 weeks, we made $10,000 on it.
You're
profit.
Kidding. You're kidding.
And it had never run that long anywhere else.
$10,000?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And he got very excited then. He decided he wanted... He was always interested in this Rice Playhouse up in Martha's Vineyard.
A summer stock playhouse.
And he gets on the phone. Poor Mrs. Rice was alive at the time. And he talked her into it.
Not for long.
And he talked her into it, and here we were. We packed all the sets.
We bought the theater from
him. Yeah. And we had to get a lorry to put all the equipment in. And we formed a company for summer stock, the basis of which was the cast of The Plough and the Stars. Went up to Martha's Vineyard. We did Eugene O'Neill plays. We did Molnair, whatever his
Chekhov.
Name. Chekhov, Shaw. Whole bunch. Very lovely artistic summer. Lost the 10,000... Plus 4,000.
Sing another song.
I've got to
sing another song. But stick to the song. Okay. That's it.
Yeah. You can see You can see, hold it, I want to just say, you can see now why Tommy and I had to leave this group and go on our own. We never got a word in edgewise.
you will, yes.
I'm going to sing a song called The Shoals.
There you are, you see. There it is. Welcome back, my friends. It is no harm to tell you at this stage that we are now inundated from all over the country with telephone calls from about 5,000 people requesting 5,000 different songs in the Clancy's repertoire. We are hardly going to be able to get to them all, but I'll take that lady out of suspense first of all by telling you that you're quite right. The jigsaw is Jim Mitchell, and you were the first one to guess it. So there you are. Could I have your name, please?
Mary Martingale.
Mary, and where are you from, Mary?
Beaumont in Dublin.
I see. And are you a fan of the Clancy's? For God's sake, give the
well,
right answer.
Well, they've just sang my song. The Shoal of Herring.
Shoal of Herring, that's yours, is it?
Yeah.
I see. Now, we have a prize for you. And if you look in there in the monitor, you'll be able to see it, because this is a Kallar Cosan gas heater. Now, it may be incongruous to give you this in the present climate, but we on The Late Show always look ahead to when when winter comes back again.
I know.
Like next Wednesday
week.
Around 2 o'clock. And that was given to us by Kallar Cosan gas. It's an Ardent Tara heater and two bottles of gas to keep you and your lovely sunburned husband warm. And that comes to a total value of about £140.
That's
so congratulations to
you.
All right, there you are. You're the best. Well done. Okay. I have no intention of asking you for any particular song.
Thank
Would you
God.
Sing again for us anyway? Do whatever comes into your mind.
Okay.
Do something else for us. What have you got?
No.
Who, actually, in the course of concerts, who decides what you're going to do?
We all decide.
I do. We all do, actually.
You don't normally have arguments on stage, though, do you? You
no,
do.
Well, it's a consensus.
How do you mean we have arguments on stage?
What are you talking about, arguments?
No, it's a very democratic process.
Yes.
We take votes, we fight, belt each other. After that, it all resolves.
And then they do what I tell them anyway. Paddy.
We'll sing a song that we learned years ago from an old man down in South Tipperary. An old man whose whole life was sweetened by the drinking of punch. It's an old favorite of ours, this song. He growled it out one night to us as the world was slipping out of focus for him. It's a song that starts out very quietly and very poetically and rapidly deteriorates.
like
St. Patrick's Day. We'd like you to join us in a jug of punch. One pleasant evening in the month of June, as I was sitting with my glass and spoon, a small bird sat on an ivy bunch, and the song he sang was the jug of punch. Do-ra-lo-ra-lo, do-ra-lo-ra-lay, do-ra-lo-ra-lo, do-ra-lo-ra-lay. A small bird sat on an ivy bunch, and the song he sang was the jug of punch. What more diversion can a man desire than to sit and down by a snug turf fire? Upon his knee a pretty wench, aye, and on the table a jug of punch. Do-ra-la-lo-ra-lo, to-ra-lo-ra-lay, do-ra-la-lo-ra-lo, to-ra-lo-ra-lay. Upon his knee a pretty wench, aye, and on the table a jug of punch. Let the doctors come with all their art, they'll make no impression upon my heart. Even the cripple forgets his hunch when he's stuck outside of a jug of punch. Do-ra-lo-ra-lo, do-ra-lo-ra-lay, do-ra-lo-ra-lo, do-ra-lo-ra-lay. Even the cripple forgets his hunch when he's stuck outside of a jug of punch. And if I get drunk, well, the money's me own, and them don't like me, they can leave me alone.
I'll tune me fiddle and I'll rosin me bow, and I'll be welcome wherever I go.
Great to have friends in the audience.
It's great to have friends in the audience, indeed. I saw a few of them there joining in. Kieran, you're very welcome. Good evening to you, and Donnie. Nice of you to come along. Old friends of the Clancy's. Kieran, just for the serious bit, as they say, for those who weren't around or weren't fully grown, as it were, at the time these fellows started, can you tell us what was it that they did that was so different?
Oh, I was going to reminisce first of all about.
Well, do then, Kieran. Tell me.
The first time I met them as a group when I was in New York in 1962, and they were all down around the village. The Greenwich Village was the place that time. It's not anymore, I don't know. No. But I was up recording old friends, fiddle players, up around Brooklyn and the Bronx. And there was one great old friend of mine named Dennis Murphy, friend of yours.
Yes.
God rest his soul. And another fiddle player named Jerry McCarty, who is now back in Dublin. And I said, uptown, you see, I said, I have to go downtown, down to the village, to meet the Clancy Brothers. And they said, Greenwich Village? You're not going down there. I said, why? Oh, that's a terrible place of sin. They're all running around in their pelt. Well, I said, it's the month of November in New York, and there's nobody running around in their pelt. And the place, I think, the lads would remember at that time was the Limelight.
That's right.
In Sheridan Square, and across the road in the Lion's Head. But I think you asked me a question, and I think I'll answer this. I've always defended the Clancy's, because people say they have prostituted the old songs. They made the old songs popular to a wider audience at a time when they weren't popular. And when people were sick to the teeth of the 20,000 John McCormacks who were around. Now, John McCormack was great, and I'm doing a program next week in America about John McCormack. But he will never be forgiven for creating the 20,000 imitators. And everybody was sick and tired of these kind of concerts. And they came along and brought a bit of fresh air and brought back the old songs in their own style. Yeah. People can argue about the way they present the traditional songs, but this was a breath of fresh air in the early beginning of the 1960s, which led a lot of people back to the basic traditional music, which has, well, been so popular ever since.
Of course, terrific, yeah.
And of course, Kieran was the first person to bring us back to Ireland to do a tour.
Were you really, Kieran? Did you make a few bob on it?
No. They made all the money. I'm still a poor man here with my poor wife looking after me. And these fellas made all the money. And if I may just remember another great friend who at that time when we brought the Clancy's back for their first tour, because they were known in America before they were known here, as a group. And I went to the late Jimmy Shields, who in fact worked in RT.
That's right.
Before he died, God rest his soul. Formerly had been manager of the Theatre Royal, and before that manager of Savoy in Limerick. And Jimmy knew the theatre business. And I said, these guys want to come back. Where will we put them? And the Olympia.
That's right.
Was the first.
And that was in 63, was it?
63, yes.
63, yes. Yes.
And
now, when Kieran says about the songs, lads, where did those songs come from? I know, Tommy, that your mother, of course, had a million songs at her beck and call. Presumably you grew up with music all the time in your house, did you?
I did.
Songs, lads, where did those songs come from? I know, Tommy, that your mother, of course, had a million songs at her beck and call. Presumably you grew up with music all the time in your house, did you?
I did, yeah. I did all kinds of maneuvers. In a pipe band, I played a piccolo, and I used to sing with a pop dance band.
The Clippertones.
Clippertones, how do you know that?
I know all these things. You played piccolo at the same time as working in the garage.
That's right.
Yes.
And I then went to work in a bar. And I was a correspondent for the Armagh Observer. Do anything for a dollar. And that's about what I got. No.
That's right. And your mammy sang all the time in the house.
Oh, she had all kinds. Well, she wouldn't have known a folk song from a hole in the ground.
Yeah.
She just sang songs, and you'd hear her singing anything. I remember she died just a year ago this month, as a matter of fact, Lord mercy her. And when she was dying, you know, she would sing anything, you see, songs that you would want to hear and songs that you wouldn't want to hear at all. She would sing, if somebody a bit rebelly came into the house, she'd sing a good Ireland song as well as she could, and she could do it. And if she would sing the other ones. But a nephew of mine went to visit her, and she thought she should do... She was on her deathbed in a hospital, and she thought she should do something sort of modern for him. So she sang Alexander's Ragtime.
Ah, dear. Irving Berlin.
That was the day before she died. Yeah, that was the day before she died.
Dear, oh, dear. Dear, oh, dear. Now, the other songs, then. Was there music in the Clancy household all the time, too?
Yes.
Yes.
Our father was an opera buff, and then in parts of the family, there was an aunt of ours had a house where there was all sorts of courtigue, as they call it, you know, singing and dancing. And it was one of those places with no electricity and a sort of a clay floor, but lovely music and lovely songs, and we learned an awful lot of the songs there. At least we heard them and we knew bits of them.
Yes.
We knew bits of a whole lot of folk songs. And later we were able to sort of put together and do some research and get the rest of the words. And very often we had to change them slightly because we were singing them in America. And there's no use in singing songs like about a peeler, for example. Didn't mean anything in America. Then we changed it to policeman. We were accused of corrupting the songs.
The first time that I became aware of the kind of the universality of folk songs was I heard Burl Ives singing Froggy Went A-Courtin' and He Did Ride. And my mother was down in the garden, it was a lovely summer's day, and I went running down to her. I said, Mammy, come up, fella, quick, there's a fella singing your song on the wireless. Because she used to sing, there was a frog lived in the well, hi, ho, said Rolly. Your own, which she had from her own mother, you know. And it was the first inkling that I had that these weren't just our songs, that they travelled all over the place and different people had modified them for their own.
Ronnie, how are you? Good evening to you. You're very welcome, and the rest of ye. Ronnie, could you put into words what these fellas meant for you?
Well, the first week after I got married, Tom paid me rent.
Why, Ronnie?
I think it was a fiver.
Why so, Ronnie, may we ask?
I hadn't got the fiver. There's an awful lot of stories we could tell, but it didn't happen in coffee shops, so they mightn't bear repeating. And not many good stories happened in coffee shops anyway.
But musically, Ronnie, I was striving for. Musically, could you suggest to us what they meant to you?
Well, I'd heard about them. I'd been in America. And I was singing in the Gay Theatre with John Malloy at the time. And I got this terrible job. I had to sing, instead of playing records in between the acts of a play, I had to go out in front and sing songs, like long songs, like, Rocks Are Born and things like that, you know, 22 verses, come back next Tuesday for the rest of it, you know what I'm saying? And I got this job, and I was jealous of these heads over in America getting all this ready for singing, and I was getting £6 a week, and having to pay readies out of it as well, you know. So anyway, I went to see them in 63 when they came here first, and it was great. And the first meeting we had with them was Barney and myself, and I don't think you were in the group, John, that time.
No, it was only the
Prince. Poor old Luke, Lord of Mercy, and I went, all that. We're all there in Kieran. And we all arrived in Carrigan Shore, and this show that John Malloy was running, Dennis Franks was the tour manager. And we arrived in Carrigonshire, and people were staying away from this gig in the hundreds.
Millions.
And we arrived in Carrigonshire, and they were staying away even more than in the hundreds. Like. So we all went to Dunmore's, all the lads and ourselves. And Kieran Burke and I said, now we better not drink much today on account of this gig tonight, you see. And we didn't drink much. That time we could drink us up. We had 4 pints each, I remember. So we all came back. And John Malloy was delighted we were all showing signs of gaggle, you see, so he could close down the show and he wouldn't have to pay anybody. So Barney said, who's drunk? I said, I'll climb up that thing, that pole. Was a, what do you call them things?
Television mast.
In the middle of the town. It wasn't television that time, it was a radio.
It was an ESB.
ESB pole. Yeah. Yeah. And Barney shot, who was drunk? And Barney climbed up to the top of it and began combing his hair in the top, you see? By which time we'd gathered all the inhabitants of Carrigonshire and Carrigbeg and the whole lot. They were all over to see us, you see? And Barney gets down, and he wouldn't get down, and he'd please promise not to arrest him. So we got down, and both sides of the street were lined up and clapping, you see? They all clapped outside, so John said, yous are all sacked. And we were all sacked, and we all went off the lads, and we had a few more.
We went back to Carter's house here.
Carter's, that's right.
Would you ever do us a little bar as a tribute to the lads? Would you ever stand up there and do a sort of a I'll go on, do. Up here, lads. Up here, lads. Stand up here in the centre where we can see and hear you. Up here. Come on. No, here'll do fine. Yeah, yeah. Here. Yeah, why not? Down there. That'd be anywhere around there. Give us a shout of something.
Give us one of the ones we stole from you.
They're
leaving in Liverpool.
They're looking as if they weren't expecting it, you see, and they all brought their instruments and everything.
Is Paddy doing a separate spot?
He might. Well, Paddy, will you join in? Come on, join in here, Paddy. Come on, join in. Paddy Riley, ladies and gentlemen, just turn up and we'll give him some. Come on, join in. Come on, good. Very good. Don't collapse.
Fine.
Very good.
Oh, there was an old woman and she lived in the wood. Wheel-a, warn ya. Down by the river, saw ya. Well, she had a baby 3 months old. Wheel-a, warn ya. She had a baby 3 months old. Down by the river, saw ya. Well, she had a penknife long and sharp.
Tommy Makem. All right then, now, where are we? Oh yes, I have to give another clue here, don't I? Is this the musical one? Oh no, it's not. No, this is number 3. All right then. Number 3. Oh, I gave No, I didn't give three. I beg your pardon. Number three coming up then. Number three clue. All right, you ready? Here it is. I live in Britain where I have my home, but I'm really quite Irish, as you might have known. All right, that's number three. We'll take a break now, all right? And we'll come back to you in a few moments with the next part of the show. See you then. Thank you very much indeed, ladies and gentlemen. All right. All right. Now. First of all, the news for you two is that Mr. Hackett of the National Manpower Service rang to say there must have been a communication breakdown about the two people in the audience, and he will set matters right first thing on Monday morning. Who says politicians don't have influence? First thing Monday morning. Now, number four clue coming up. Are you ready? This is a musical clue. You standing by, Tommy?
Of course.
Okay, hold on. Here it is. Eliza and Henry fought quite a bit. She's no help, but the professor might clinch it. I thought you did that beautifully, Tommy. I really do.
Thank you. Think of what beautiful. It's going to cost you.
And there's, you'll be lucky. And there's one clue yet to go. But first of all, I have to say that there is a young couple in the audience joining us tonight. Anne Harvey, Barbara and Stephen Coughlin. I beg your pardon, that's Anne Harvey. Barbara and Stephen Coughlin. Is that yourselves?
Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, God, you're very dark up there. I can't see you at all. Maybe you just want to stay out of the limelight. This young couple, ladies and gentlemen, proposed. He proposed to her and she proposed. No, you proposed to him, didn't you? That's right. She proposed to him on the radio program on Valentine's Day. On the radio program, on one more. And he said yes. And then she said yes. And it did go all right, did it?
It did, yes.
Excellent, thanks.
Wonderful.
Yeah,
and how long are you married now?
4 weeks today.
4 weeks. Well, who's counting? Yes. And it's going all right. It's going nice, isn't it? Now, as everybody in the audience will know, once you get married, you settle in, as it were, and you sort of become lazy, and you don't go out as much as usual, and then she feeds you very well, and you make food for her, and you sit around, and you don't get any exercise. So, in view of the fact that that will happen to you, like all good married people, we are giving you two membership cards to the Tivoli Health and Leisure Centre. There you will have for yourselves a year's membership. You will have a fully equipped gymnasium, aerobic studio, fully supervised creche, well, never know, a lovely jacuzzi, a pool, a team of qualified instructors and all of that, a membership card for each one of you. They're on Clonliffe Road.
Thank
and we
you
hope
you
enjoy you. Yourselves and use it well, all right? Congratulations to you. Very good. All right. Now, we are still being inundated with requests, and we've taken a democratic vote in the studio. Didn't we take a democratic vote?
Yes.
And it fell to the lot of Tommy to sing The Cobbler.
Guys.
Oh, my name is Dick Darby, I'm a cobbler. I serve in my time at the old camp. Some call me an old agitator, but now I'm resolved to repent. With me ing twing of an ing thing of an idol. With me ing twing of an ing thing of an idol. With me roo boo boo roo boo boo randy. And my lapstone keeps betting away. Now my father was hung for sheep stealing. My mother was born for a witch. My sister's a dandy housekeeper. And I'm a mechanical switch. With me ing twing of an ing thing of an idle. With me ing twing of an ing thing of an idle. With me roo-boo-boo-roo-boo-boo-randy and me lapstone keeps betting away. And my wife, she is humpy, she's lumpy. My wife, she's the devil, she's cracked. And no matter what I may do with her, her tongue, it goes clickety-clack. With me ing-twing of an ing-thing of an idle. With me ing twing of an ing thing of an idle. With me roo boo boo roo boo boo randy. and me lapstone keeps bitten away. It was early one fine summer's morning, a little before it was day, I dipped her three times in the river and carelessly bade her good day. With me ing-twing of an ing-thing of an eye-do, with me ing-twing of an ing-thing of an eye-did, with me roo-boo-boo-roo-boo-boo-randy, and me lapstone keeps beating away.
Tommy, as a matter of interest, riddle me this. Where did that song come from?
I learned it from a woman called Mary Toner, who lived down the street from us. She kept a little sweetie shop. Her husband was a bread man and a hunts man, Joe, and she had a book of songs that she had written out by hand when she was a young girl. She worked as a servant girl in a pub in the town, and she liked the songs. But there was a great connection between her family and my family, because her family were the Kellys, who owned a mill in Derry Noose, and all the Kellys were magnificent step dancers. I saw Ned Kelly, when he was 94, step dancing at a wedding. Fantastic dancers. And he told me that the sign of a good dancer at that time was that you would get a girl out to face you at a party, and any good dancer had to be able to kick her apron over her head on the last step of the dance. An awful lot of accidents, but if you were a good dancer, you didn't disturb anything except the apron, and he could do it. Yeah. But the Kellys always danced, and my father and his brother, they worked in the mill for the Kellys, but they used to play the music for them. They played fiddles and flutes and things.
It's a most unusual little song, isn't it?
Yes, and she told me that when she was a young girl, when she went to the parties where she got it first, there were two old men that used to sing it, and when they'd be asked to sing, I don't know whether they're brothers or not, they used to get two stools and sit in the middle of the floor and face each other, and some girl would kick off her two shoes and they would take a shoe apiece and hold it between their knees, and they'd do the sewing, the two men facing each other.
Yeah. And did she teach you how to do the action?
She taught me how to do that, yeah. She was great.
A lovely story.
I remember one night in Carnegie Hall, we had sung that, or Tommy had sung it so often, the audience came to expect it, and we decided we'd play a trick on him. And he announced the cobbler, a big round of applause, of course. Tommy walked off the stage, and Paddy and Tom and I sat up, the three of us.
And we did it.
That is the other extraordinary thing, that so many of your songs, as soon as you start to sing them, everybody joins in. I mean, this must happen regularly in America and so on, wherever you go.
You know, it was so extraordinary, Dave, when Tommy did come to America, and I met Tommy for the first time in America. And you were asking earlier about where did we get the songs, or how did they come about. It was so strange that Tommy seemed to know all the same songs that I knew when I was young. And I'm sure Tommy had somewhat of the same experience with us. We somehow or other had learned a lot of these songs here when we were in Ireland when we were young.
Yes, but they were songs that were ignored by the young people.
Oh my God.
They were all rubbishy.
I'll tell you why. They were songs that were associated with poverty.
Is that what it was?
Ah, yes.
Yeah.
And when we realized during the folk boom in America that people were asking us to sing songs, we were kind of embarrassed not knowing any, and initially very timid about singing the songs that we did know. And they got such a tremendous response that we began to stick the shoulders back and sing them out and get a bit of blackguarding into them, as we say.
And get paid for it.
That too. Yeah. But I think that the success of the songs for us was very much a part of the American thing. That nobody in America really is embarrassed about anything. And none of the connotations of poverty that might have been attached to the songs in Ireland were there. And when we came back to Ireland singing them, the people here, that thing was infectious. They began to listen to us and say, if they can sing them, God, we can sing.
We can all do that. My mother used to sing. Yes, my mother used to sing that. Joe used to sing that. Joe Kennedy, good evening to you. You're very welcome. So what was your association now with the lads in the early days, Joe?
Well, I was working on a paper, not the Evening Press, where I am now. And I'd heard Ciarán playing records. I was interested in the music, and from years, early years. And when they came to Ireland, there was a newspaper interview, and a number of us went along to talk to them. And I had remember meeting Liam 10 years beforehand, or 15 years beforehand, at an interview for a job in an insurance company, the Zurich Insurance Company on Dawson Street.
You too, Joe.
Yeah, there was a line of us waiting outside, and Mr. Deal was the boss.
Were you in that too?
Yeah.
Not in that particular one.
No, but anyway... Mr. Clancy got the job. He had 7 honours in his leaving cert.
So who got it?
There.
Liam Clancy got the job in the Zurich Insurance. A good company.
But he didn't stay very long. I think it drove him crazy, and he started taking acting lessons in Brenton Smith or something like that. And he went off collecting folk songs and went to America with Tommy Makem. But then he came back, like famous 10 years later or whatever, and I went along to talk to him and with other newspaper people. And we just kept in touch, and... It was a sensational thing at the time, what they did. It influenced a lot of young people. I was about 28 at the time, it's a long time ago, but younger people, much younger than me, became influenced by what they were doing, and it brought out a lot of talent in young people who perhaps it never would have happened.
That's right.
And also, which is very important folk singers in this country whom we've never listened to or paid any attention to, such as Seamus O'Haney, and even Seamus Ennis, although he was on radio and a household name. Younger people listen to them for the first time. Liam Clancy, when I started to talk to him, I always remember this. He said, "What are you doing wasting your time talking to me? You should be talking to Joe Heaney." I said, "Who's Joe Heaney?" So I said, "Come on and listen to him." So he took me up to O'Donoghue's, and Joe Heaney was sitting in the corner, and he started to sing. And this was a different type of music altogether. I'd never heard anything like it in my life before, but it was terrific stuff, you know. They did this. This was a very good thing to do, I think, from a folklore point of view, apart from the commercial.
I think, Joe, also many people don't realise that by doing what they did, and they did it happenschance and serendipity and all of those words, that's a word you wouldn't know, by doing what they did, they paved the way for all of those groups who came along.
I mean,
up to and including Horslips and Clannad
and
all of those.
The talent was there, but it was encouraged to come out, I think. Heaven knows what would have happened. I don't know what would have happened if they hadn't broken through an old mould, as Ciarán was talking about earlier.
Yes.
You know, Mother McCree and all that sort of stuff. You know?
That was Irish music.
That was it, yeah. Does your mother come from Ireland?
And Lochamar and so on. Yeah. There's a lady of the audience wants to know, how did Tommy meet you? How did you become involved with him?
We met, there was a lady called Deanne Hamilton was coming over to Ireland to collect folk songs. And Paddy and Tom had known her in New York, and she was going to visit their home in Carrick-on-Shore, and she was coming up to collect songs from my mother. And Liam was down there, and she had called at the Clancy home, and Liam came up to Katie.